In every conflict in history, the soldier on the ground has been ultimately concerned with his own personal safety. No matter what the orders might be to advance or attack, in the forefront of every soldier's mind is the desire to survive. Swords break in the heat of battle, rifles jam, machine guns run out of ammunition. And who in battle would refuse having an extra weapon available to avoid becoming defenseless if they could afford it? The restrictions on a backup weapon are size and weight. A dagger or small mace suited the needs of the medieval soldier. In modern times, nothing has been appreciated more in desperate situations than having a pistol at your side. Light, easy to conceal, comfortable to wear for long periods, and deadly. The pistol has replaced the sword as the most common and recognizable weapon in the world today. The pistol was originally designed as a cavalry weapon, but over the centuries it has changed role and meaning as often as it has changed design. Its purpose as a military weapon seems variously to have been as a status symbol to distinguish rank, as a comforter to build confidence in hopeless or dangerous situations, or to silently symbolize authority in occupied territory. Despite filmic images of sharpshooting cowboys who can hit bad guys at 700 yards with a trusty Smith & Wesson, in reality, in a conflict situation, the inability of most marksmen to hit anything that isn't either very large or very close has been another well-documented feature of pistol use throughout the ages. As we chart the development of the pistol from its humblest beginnings, we will examine its changing role and look at some of the questions facing us about the application of pistols in the 21st century.
The previous way of defending yourself would have been with a sword or a dagger or a knife, a sidearm. And the drawbacks of a sidearm like that is you would have to have a degree of personal fitness or physical skill to be able to use it effectively. With a pistol, you immediately became equal to anybody. It became the great leveler, the great equalizer.
The very first pistol was simply a shortened matchlock gun. It was meant as a defense weapon for short distances and was used mainly by army officers. These weapons developed at the same technological rate as their rifle counterparts. The earliest forms of shooting had an effective range of only about 30 to 40 yards. Because of the lack of precision between the barrel and the projectile, was wholly inaccurate.
The early pistols had a number of problems. One, of course, was that they were one-shot affairs. Secondly, they were prone to misfire. The ignition system was chancy, to say the least. The other problem was that because they were muzzle-loading, you couldn't have too tight a fit when you put the ball down the barrel, otherwise you'd risk jamming the thing in there. This means, of course, that when the explosion takes place and the ball is expelled, the hot gases rush around either side of the ball and it wobbles as it goes down the barrel. And so you've got a weapon which is both pretty inaccurate over any distance greater than perhaps 20 to 30 feet and which rapidly loses its muzzle velocity.
Using these weapons against heavily armored knights on horseback who are charging towards you with lances must have been an exceedingly unattractive prospect, especially when wind and moisture could easily affect the powder exposed at the touch hole. The device would often fail to go off at all. The need for a more reliable ignition system was obvious, not least because it was incredibly difficult to light a match and hold it to the touch hole with one hand and hold the gun steady with the other, let alone aim it in medieval battles.
Gunpowder burned, and burned quite vigorously, but you had to apply fire to it. And this meant that if you were trying to use a pistol or a musket in windy conditions or in rainy conditions, it would misfire.
The first advance came with the development of the flash pan. The touch hole was moved to the side of the barrel and a covered cup was attached at the opening. The cup had a lid that could be opened and a small amount of gunpowder inside that could be easily ignited. This in turn would go through the hole and ignite the powder in the barrel. The lid prevented the powder from blowing away or getting damp. In 1517, Johann Kaifus of Nuremberg developed the principle used in spring-driven tinder lighters at the time for use in firearms and invented the wheel lock ignition system. A round metal disc with a coil spring was wound up with a key and blocked with a catch. When the trigger was pulled, the catch was released and the disc rotated at speed, scraping along a flint. This is the same principle, basically, as a modern disposable flint wheel cigarette lighter, and it threw off sparks into the flash pan, causing ignition. The design problems of the matchlocks had been solved at a stroke.
The ignition mechanism used on early guns was a smouldering piece of cord, a matchlock. And until a self-contained ignition system was developed, it was impractical to carry a pistol round with a burning bit of string. So as soon as the first self-igniting mechanism came in, which was the wheel lock, it was possible to make an arm that was self-igniting, that you could carry loaded with you and fire off at an instant's notice. That's when pistols came into being. Initially, they were just scaled down long guns, scaled down muskets, and gradually they took on a shape of their own. The angle of the stock changed so they're more convenient to use, and people started carrying these smaller weapons for defense and for attack.
But the new wheel lock weapons proved too expensive, at over twice the price of their predecessors, and as a result, the matchlock remained the weapon of choice for army use. The next step in the evolution of the handgun was the advent of the snap hands in 1570. It was basically an early form of flintlock and was not dissimilar to a wheel lock with the wheel and the spring mechanism omitted. In 1612, the flintlock was developed in France and in the Louvre gun shops, with Marin de Bourgeois, under the patronage of King Henry IV, being credited with its creation. The main difference between the flintlock and the snap hands is that with the flintlock, the striking surface and the flash pan cover are one and the same. With the snap hands, they were separate pieces.
This is a flintlock mechanism of the early 1800s, typical to muskets and to pistols. To work it, to operate it, you pull the cock back to the safety position. Once it's at the half cock position, you load the pan with priming powder, small amount of priming powder, and shut the combined pan cover and frizzen face down onto it. You pull the cock back to the full cock position, and it's now ready to fire. And when you pull the trigger, the flint stone in the jaws of the cock flies forwards and scrapes red-hot sparks from that frizzen face, at the same time throwing it back, revealing the priming powder in the pan and igniting it. And that burning priming powder flashes through to the main charge in the breech. I'll show you how it goes. And it's a misfire. We'll try it one more time.
The main problems with the flintlock is that if you have a lot of movement with them, as the trigger is fired and the hammer goes forward, or the swan cock in this piece, it pushes the frizzen forward and the sparks may not go in the pan and ignite the powder. The wind may catch it as the frizzen goes forward and blow some of the powder out, if not all of it. If it's raining, gunpowder or black powder is hydroscopic. It absorbs a lot of water and therefore may not ignite. So there were limitations to the use of this weapon. Also, the range of it. The range of the weapon 25 metres, maybe 100 metres, with any reasonable accuracy. Okay, and even then it was pretty hit or miss. And finally, it took a long time to reload the weapon. You had to reprime the pan, you had to reprime the powder in the chamber or in the barrel. You had to put a lead ball in it and ram it. Okay, so it took a long time to load. I suppose one of the ways they would have used it is having fired it once, they'd have turned it around and used it as a club.
Pistols spread in use from army to civilian life, partly as a result of sport shooting, but more particularly due to their duelling application. In France, the pistol had been acceptable as a duelling weapon since the 16th century, and the new flintlock pistols caught on immediately as a weapon of choice for duelling, which itself was enjoying unprecedented popularity at the French court in the latter half of the 17th century. So much so, in fact, that King Louis XIV was forced to outlaw the practice in 1679 because of the almost daily casualties. In other European nations, pistols were considered an ungentlemanly way of settling matters of honour, and the sword and sabre were preferred right up until the 18th century. In the hunt for equanimity, the duelling pistol was standardised in 1777 as a 9 or 10 inch barrelled, smoothbore flintlock of 1 inch bore, carrying a ball of 48 to the pound. The advent of pairs of identical duelling pistols and the establishment of codes of honour for duelling with pistols meant that by the 19th century, single shot flintlocks were the standard weapons of duelling right across Europe. The acceptance of the pistol over the sword as the tool of choice for settling matters of honour may have had less to do with the noble traditions of the past, however, and more to do with the financial traditions of the gunsmith. After all, even if thoroughly insulted, did either party really wish to die?
Dueling with pistols replaced dueling with swords, because with swords, one or other of you got hurt. With pistols, it was less risky, shall we say. It was sufficiently dangerous that you could get killed, but the odds are you were unlikely to get killed and you were unlikely even to get injured. Most parties walked away unharmed. The pistols used were always impeccably made, but they weren't overly efficient. There was no rifling in the barrel because the gun makers didn't want their customers shooting each other. They were smoothbored, which removed a lot of the effectiveness of them. So they weren't that lethal, but they were nevertheless very desirable weapons. Every gentleman had a pair of these.
Alongside the development of single-shot pistols for sport and duels, came the development of pistols with more than one barrel, the first of which appeared in around 1650. These two, three, or even four-barrel pistols were designed for use in close-quarter defensive situations, for example, against highwaymen, predators, or rabid dogs. Prototype flintlock revolvers were also developed in the late 17th and early 18th centuries, but without any great degree of success. The next stage in the development of firearms was made possible in 1799 by the invention of fulminating mercury by an English chemist named Edward Howard. The useful trait of the chemical compound fulminate of mercury is that it explodes when it is struck. The firearms potential of this new material was seized upon by, of all people, a clergyman, the Reverend Alexander John Forsyth of Aberdeenshire, who in 1807 patented the percussion principle. A year later, he developed fulminate, which is highly explosive, and designed a small cap that would hold a small quantity of it. The percussion cap ignition system was born.
This is a pistol which is made to make use of the percussion cap. And so you have a hammer here, which pulls back, and you can see the nipple there. And the percussion cap is placed upon the nipple, containing the mercury fulminate, so that when the trigger is pulled and the hammer is released, it's smashed. The hammer detonates the mercury fulminate, and the flash goes through to the gunpowder.
As soon as you had the percussion system, it was much easier to make a firearm. You suddenly generate a birth of cheap firearms. no longer had the expertise needed to make a flintlock mechanism. You could simply make an anvil with a nipple on it that struck by a simple hammer and the gun would fire.
A major thing was to develop some way of turning the one-shot pistol into some sort of revolver. The notion that you could have several shots fired from the same weapon. Sometimes they experimented with several barrels, but in the early 19th century they began thinking of cylinders revolving, rotating, with bullets inside these.
In 1836, the 22-year-old Samuel Colt patented the Colt firearm with rotating cylinder for 5 or 6 bullets. Compared to the single-shot flintlocks of the time, this percussion revolver brought with it a huge increase in firepower. He began manufacturing the Colt Patterson 1836 at his New Jersey factory that same year, and became the manager of his own company, the Patent Arms Manufacturing Company.
Colt's principle was, one, he used percussion ignition. He used a revolving cylinder firing all its shots through a single barrel. It worked simply by cocking the hammer and pulling the trigger. It was a thumb-cocking mechanism, nice and simple. And that mechanism operated a pull which rotated the cylinder each time, so that every time you cocked the hammer, you rotated to a freshly loaded chamber and you could fire the shot off.
It works very simply by putting the powder into the chamber, putting a ball on top of it, rotating it round, and then obviously ramming the ball down on top, and by putting a cap in. This improved the speed of firing because you had 6 shots instead of 1. Unfortunately, it took about 2 minutes to reload it. So again, it had a limitation.
Over the next few years, he designed and developed 3 other revolvers, the Colt holster, the Colt belt model, and the Colt pocket, and 2 rotating cylinder rifles. But following poor sales of the rifles, the company went bankrupt in 1842. However, successful use of the Patterson revolvers in the Indian Wars of 1845 led to collaboration with a US Army captain, Samuel H. Walker, in 1846, and the invention of the heavy Colt 1846 Walker. The US Army ordered 1,000 of them, and Colt was back in business. By 1856, Colt's Patent Arms Manufacturing Company, as it was now called, was producing nearly 55,000 revolvers a year from its factory in Hartford, Connecticut. It also established a factory in England to supply the European market and developed a network of sales agencies right across the USA to sell his weapons. Samuel Colt died in 1862, but not before he'd seen the devastating consequences of the accuracy and power of the 500,000 revolvers that he'd produced in his lifetime, and the horrifying slaughter of the American Civil War. The company survived him and a fire which burnt the factory to the ground in 1864 and went on to make a major contribution to firearms development later in the century and beyond. The next important development was the advent of the single cartridge. At first, this was just a paper casement inside which the powder charge and the bullet had been pre-packed. Later, the primer was added to the combination.
It became obvious that you didn't just have to have a flask pouring the gunpowder down, that you could have prepared measures of gunpowder. Prepared measures put in a spool of paper, and you would just drop that down the barrel and bang it into place. Then you could put the ball in, and once again, it would be evident that it would be worth trying to attach the ball by wrapping paper around it or by otherwise attaching it. And so you have the beginnings of an integrated bullet. This is then where the percussion cap comes in, because a bright spark realized that you could put a bit of metal at the base of this and put a dab of mercury fulminate in it. And then you could have some kind of striker hitting that and detonating it, or indeed a hammer, as in the Colt 45.
These revolutionary single cartridges would in turn require a revolution in the weapons that would fire them, since they could no longer be loaded through the muzzle. It would therefore be necessary to design a method for opening the solid end of the barrel, which could then be securely locked shut for firing after the cartridge had been loaded inside. Horace Smith and Daniel B. Wesson founded the first Smith & Wesson Company in 1852. In 1854, they won the gold medal for design at the Baltimore Exposition for their Volcano lever-action pistol with built-in tubular magazine. The main technological achievements were, firstly, that it was capable of firing as fast as the operator could pump the lever action, and secondly, and more importantly, that it fired a full self-contained cartridge. The mass production of this gun signaled the beginning of the end for the percussion revolvers of Colt's company. Smith & Wesson sold the design and their shares in the company to Winchester, who continued its production until 1866.
The cartridge, as soon as it was made practical, was instantly adopted. It was infinitely better than playing around with loose powder and a ball. And it made gun construction simpler.
Smith & Wesson set up a new company in Springfield, Massachusetts in 1856 in order to produce a pocket revolver designed by Wesson. However, it was discovered in the last minute that Roland White had already established patents for some of the parts of the gun. An agreement was reached with him, bringing into being a product that was to change firearms forever. The Smith & Wesson Model 1 revolver fired a .22 caliber rimfire cartridge and was the Model T Ford of handguns. They were inexpensive and easy to use. Mass production meant that for the first time, nearly everybody could afford a firearm, and that for the first time, you could get spare parts quite easily. Demand was so high that Smith & Wesson were forced to move to a bigger factory in 1859. Patent rights ran for 15 years at this time, and the successful fighting of a vast number of lawsuits gave the company a virtual monopoly on what was effectively the only modern revolver.
Another effect that the integrated cartridge had was to force gun makers to move to standard calibers for guns. The cartridge makers, the bullet makers, want some kind of standard calibers appearing.
In 1861, Smith & Wesson introduced the .32 caliber rimfire Model 2. The Civil War had hugely increased demand for firearms, and they literally couldn't make the new weapons fast enough to keep up with demand. After the war, they established sales offices across Europe and sold a great deal of Model 2s to the Russian army. Good sales allowed the introduction of a .44 caliber rimfire Model 3 in 1869. The Russian army was again so impressed that they ordered 20,000 straight off. The Colt Company was finally legally able to start production of a fully bored cylinder revolver for center-firing metal cartridges in 1872. The result was a spectacular success for Colt.
We've now moved on to a center-fire cartridge, which is this sort of thing, which is a brass cartridge case with a lead bullet in the end. This particular weapon is a Colt Peacemaker type weapon, and it was very simple. All you did was you could load the cartridge into the chamber from here, and you simply rotated the chamber around, loading the cartridges in as you went. Speeded up loading and was therefore much more useful than the percussion lock.
The great advantage of it was apparently that it was tremendously reliable. You could break just about any part of it and you could still make it work. Even if the hammer didn't work, you could take a stone and bang the end of it and you would get a detonation.
This is more of a cowboy western type gun. It would be used as a tool really for like local protection against things like snakes or particular nasty people that were having a go against him. Or it could be turned around as most cowboys used and used as a hammer as well sometimes for knocking in fence pins.
The iconic Colt single action army, the so-called Peacemaker, was in uninterrupted production in a variety of models for 68 years and became known as the gun that won the West. In 1892, Joseph Laumann created the first semi-automatic pistol. The development of nitro powder had increased gas pressure in the barrel, and therefore the range of pistols had been similarly increased. However, range already exceeded effective accuracy before the advent of nitro powder, so this was not the most useful aspect of the development. The real advance came from the fact that the increase in pressure was sufficient for some of the high gas pressure to be used for an automatic locking system for the barrel. The semi-automatic pistol was suddenly a possibility. Laumann's pistol worked by using the explosion in the chamber to blow back the bolt against a spring. The spring then returned the bolt, loading a new cartridge and leaving the pistol cocked and ready to fire.
By about 1890, the revolver advanced as far as it could. There wasn't much way of improving the revolver. It had one major drawback. Even when using the self-cocking mode, it needed considerable force to pull the trigger to operate the mechanism and rotate the cylinder. Now, Zahara Maxim at that stage had already invented a Maxim machine gun, which worked on recoil, so the recoil of a fired round would not only extract the empty case, but it would also load a fresh round. And people applied the same principle to magazine pistols.
In 1893, Hugo Borchardt introduced the idea of having a separate removable magazine contained in the grip. This became and remains the defining characteristic of the breed. This development was exactly what the munitions industry had been waiting for, and a series of semi-automatics were produced in rapid succession.
It's not until about 1893 that a genius appears on the scene, and this is George Luger, who was working for a company in Berlin called the Luger Company, the Lion Company. And Luger really looks at the two or three designs, the patents that he has in front of him, and thinks, I can improve upon that, I can improve upon that. And so he produces one of the classics, which is the German Luger pistol, the Parabellum.
The toggle lock mechanism of the Luger is its most distinguishing feature. It works because it can sustain a heavy weight when straight, but when it's bent, continues to bend easily. The toggle joint in its straight back position resists the rearward pressure of the detonated cartridge, then buckles after sufficient time elapses. When a round is fired, the entire breech, barrel and toggle move straight forward on rails until the toggle begins to ride up on a pair of cams that breaks the toggle by making it bend at the joint. Once the toggle joint is no longer straight, it bends freely, allowing the bolt to come rearward and the striker to be cocked. The spent cartridge is extracted by a combination extractor loaded chamber indicator on the top of the toggle and is ejected as the toggle nears the end of its rearward travel. And a new round is stripped from the magazine and chambered as the toggle is driven back to the straight position by a spring. The original Luger was a 7.65 caliber and was accepted by the Swiss as their service pistol in 1900. However, the calibration was deemed too small during the US Army trials, where it lost out to the Colt Browning 1911. And this rebuff set Luger to work on the 9mm cartridge and associated modifications. It was accepted as a service pistol, first by the German Navy in 1904, and then by the German Army in 1908.
They're still being made today. They're used all over the world. Many different police forces have used them in the past. They've been used in two main world wars, and they turn up regularly in all kinds of arms cases and things. I personally have found them to be what I call a dirty gun. In other words, when they get dirty, they jam. But having said that, they are extremely accurate.
The pistol was a good and convenient way of keeping all Germans armed in hostile occupied territory at all times. During this time, the Luger became itself the iconic symbol of the forces of occupation. Each of the countries fighting the First World War had its own service revolver or pistol, and all had their merits. The Luger was, however, generally considered to be the best of the bunch.
Even though it's issued theoretically to the officers, quite a few soldiers like to have a pistol. They had their rifle as their weapon, but it's an awkward weapon in trench fighting, close quarter stuff, and they are encouraged to use firstly, hand grenades, which is fair enough, but you can only carry two or three of these, or the bayonet. And I think a lot of the soldiers felt they didn't really much like the bayonet. They would rather have a standoff weapon with a slightly greater range and where you didn't have much in the way of swordsman skills.
In Germany, they went for automatic weapons in a big way. A lot of people in the military went for the automatic weapons. It became the standard sidearm. In England, throughout the First World War and almost up to the Second World War, we stuck with cartridge revolvers.
The Webley Mark VI was the standard-issue British service pistol during World War I. The Mark VI was an 11.6mm caliber weapon and proved immensely reliable in wartime conditions, even in Flanders mud, and was issued to all British officers as well as many others, including military policemen and officers from Empire countries. The Webley, it seems, was an extremely comforting thing to have with you if you found yourself in a tight spot. For this reason, they were exceedingly popular with tank crews, air crews, machine gun crews, and anybody else who was likely to find themselves isolated or alone. Stopping power was very much an issue during the World Wars, because if the gun wouldn't stop a man with one shot then, in all probability, the shooter was likely to get a bayonet in the head shortly afterwards, a situation the British were already familiar with from the colonial wars.
When you put metal jacketing over the bullet in the 1880s, this lack of stopping power became apparent. And the British at the Battle of Omdurman found this, that in fact they had wounded a great many of the Mahdi. But then when they started going across the battlefield to take souvenirs and that kind of thing, wounded Mahdi would arise and with a spear attempt to spear them. And so the army was always very keen for large caliber, which had the greater stopping power, and hence the 0.45 size that was required. And that was the answer. The Webley, of course, was a large caliber revolver used by the British officers in the First World War.
The French standard issue was the Lebel revolver, or model d'ordonnance. Designed in 1892, it fired 6 8mm rounds and resembled the Webley in both reliability and longevity. It lasted right through the Second World War as well. The major difference between the two guns was in the loading mechanism. Where the Webley snapped open, the Lebel's chamber swung out. John Browning began designing for the Colt Company in 1891. His most famous designs include the Colt Browning 1900 7.65mm bedroom pistol and the Colt 0.45-inch 1911 semi-automatic, which was the American service pistol throughout the first half of the 20th century.
The Americans were much slower into this until John Moses Browning came on the scene towards the end of the 1890s. But he found it very difficult to interest anyone in America, and so he moved to Belgium and he used the Fabrique Nationale factory. And they are the people who begin to make his automatic weapon.
This is a Colt 45, model of 1911. This has been going for many years, still used quite exclusively by the public in America, although it went out of service with the American Army a few years ago. It's a pretty ergonomic weapon. It has proved itself over various wars, from Korea, First World War, Second World War. Very useful weapon.
The Beretta used by the Italian army in the First War was the Beretta model 1915. This was a single action pistol with a recoil locking system and was standard in 7.65mm caliber and a 7-round magazine. Surely the strangest looking of the First World War weapons, the C96 Mauser, or broom handle Mauser as it's better known, was the first commercially successful semi-automatic pistol. It had a 10-shot magazine with a distinctive round grip. It wasn't an official weapon, but it was adopted and used by members of all sides in the conflict.
This is a Mauser of a European manufacturer, okay, Mauser being German, and it comes in a sort of wooden case, if you like, a wooden carry holster, which is also part of the stock. It clips on the end. Because it had the shoulder stock on this particular weapon, it was much more accurate over longer ranges. Although the sights go up to about 800, 900 or 1,000 yards on some of these, I think it's, even with the shoulder stock, it was pretty hard going to actually get around out that far. But up to a couple hundred yards, it would have been quite effective. But it was very fine precision machined. And the problems with this particular weapon was that if it got dirty, it tended to malfunction and jam quite a bit, unlike the revolver.
The semi-automatic pistols and durable revolvers of the First World War almost uniformly survived to play a big part in the Second World War. Given the inherent limitations of pistols in terms of range and accuracy, it's fair to say that the designers had, by the beginning of the 20th century, developed them into sufficiently effective killing instruments if used correctly.
Both revolvers and automatics are very similar in performance. There's not a lot to choose from. Most countries now have adopted the automatic pistol as a standard sidearm. Very few use the revolver anymore. The revolver is still used by police authorities in the States and such like, although it's largely being phased out. They've both reached virtually a state of perfection.
Modern advances in pistol technology have finally found solutions to some old problems. The laser sight, for example, has done much to improve accuracy, and multiple automatic safety systems have also eliminated the possibility of accidental discharge unless the trigger is pulled. But the most far-reaching advances in pistol technology in the late 20th and early 21st centuries have been concerned with the use of new materials. After the Second World War, stainless steel became common in pistol production. In 1980, Glock introduced the first synthetic polymer, or plastic frame, amidst much furore and controversy. The Glock 17 was immediately dubbed the Terrorist Special by some sections of a hysterical American media, due to assumptions that it wouldn't be able to be picked up by airport metal detectors, which was, of course, absolute nonsense. Many manufacturers are now using synthetic materials in the manufacture of their weapons, with plastic casings being particularly prevalent.
Most of the frames now are made of plastic of some high butyl nylon or whatever, and the slides and the working parts are made of steel. They're much more lightweight than the previous guns, like the Colt 45, which was all steel construction. They're very large capacity magazined weapons. Again, mostly ambidextrous, as you can see, there are safety catches on both sides.
In 1988, some manufacturers began to use titanium in pistol production, first as a protective layer and then to fashion hull components. But the real material breakthrough came with the scandium-aluminium alloy introduced by Smith & Wesson in 2001. Inexpensive, light, metal alloys could be made infinitely stronger and much more wear-resistant with the addition of small amounts of scandium. And an extremely large amount of scandium had just been discovered in the Ukraine. The new scandium pistols were also far more pressure-resistant, as well as lighter, corrosive-free, and more robust. Some of the most popular handguns of the late 20th and early 21st centuries are the Sig Sauer range of pistols, which are favored by much of the American law enforcement community, the Walther P990, which are used by the British Police Armed Response Units, the Beretta Model 92, which the US Army finally adopted to replace the J.M. Browning-designed Colt 1911 pistol, the Glock series of safe-action pistols, and the IMI Desert Eagle .50 AE or Action Express caliber, which is the most powerful handgun ever put into production.
This is an IMI, Israeli Military Industries Desert Eagle. This particular one is in .44 caliber. They do come in .38, .41 and, would you believe, .50. My personal opinion of these things is that they're very, very big, they're very, very heavy, and I would actually have no use for one of these myself. It completely defeats the object of having a pistol. It must be 6 or 7 pounds easily of just solid steel weight. It's an extra weight that I don't need to carry around.
An interesting debate has developed from the recent advances of wound ballistic technology over the use of dum-dum bullets in modern pistols. These bullets were originally developed by the British Army and take their name from dum-dum in India, where they were manufactured in the 1890s. They were a type of rifle bullet with lead exposed at the tip, which expanded upon impact, causing such enormous ravages in the body, its entrance being very small, but its exit very large. In 1899, the Hague Peace Conference tabled a discussion as to whether the bullets aggravated wounds and increased the suffering of the wounded, and whether that suffering could be deemed necessary. The British agreed about the effect of the bullets, but argued that there was a difference between using the bullets against so-called civilized nations and using them against savages. They complained that, although run through two or three times, the savage does not cease to advance. Fortunately, sense prevailed, and the use of bullets which expand or flatten easily in the human body, such as bullets with a hard envelope which doesn't entirely cover the core or is pierced with incisions in armed conflict, was prohibited by international treaty. However, in the 21st century, police forces worldwide use pistols that fire lead-tipped bullets that both expand and flatten on impact. This is not technically against the treaty because it only covered international armed conflict, and surprisingly, wounds ballistics show that this apparent paradox should not necessarily be of concern for those with interests in humanitarian law.
Ammunition these days is even more specialized than the weaponry. They're looking for ways of making a not very big bullet fired from a not very big gun have nevertheless the stopping power approaching that of a rifle. And so shape of cartridge, the nature of the filling, and above all, the nature of the bullet begins to be important.
The use of lead-exposed tip bullets by police forces can be justified for two reasons. Firstly, the bullets are most likely to be fired in self-defense at short range in order to facilitate the rapid incapacitation of an attacker, and as such, the stopping power of the lead-exposed tip reduces the likelihood of having to shoot the attacker twice. And secondly, the rapid energy diffusion reduces the likelihood of the bullet passing through the attacker and entering somebody else. As ever, the two main modern users of the pistol are the civilian and the military. Civilian and law enforcement drive an enormous volume of production in the United States, while personal protection is a high priority for many. And as in the past, a large percentage of the population has access to a pistol for defense or sporting use.
The market is very largely a civilian one these days. It's not just gangsters. There is the successful, reputable businessman. There's the less successful, not so reputable businessman. But also there is the housewife. Once the bad guys have got huge access to guns, then the average law-abiding citizen is going to think that it might be a good idea to equip themselves with it. It certainly seems to be the case in America.
But there are still a lot of people overseas who use revolvers, use classic designs of revolvers, copies of Western arms, even muzzle-loading revolvers, copies of weapons made in the 1840s, 50s, 60s. So that demand keeps them going, that demand calls for revolvers. People are still always happy to shoot revolvers.
Every country's military force has adopted one or another of the modern pistols as a standard sidearm. Officers, airmen, tank crews, and artillery crews are all issued with sidearms so that they will not be distracted from their main task by the weight of an assault rifle, but can protect themselves should the need arise. Covert and special forces are also issued with pistols. The unusual and diverse nature of their missions welcome the weapon for its ability to be concealed. Weapon design has found itself led by the special requirements of modern covert warfare. Incredibly effective silent pistols have been built for assassinations, overcoming the noise of a bullet breaking the sound barrier, and the explosion that propels it to make it one of the most deadly short-range weapons in the world. Development continues. Although the primary structure and function of a modern pistol would be recognizable to a soldier of the First World War, indeed, in a matter of minutes, he would no doubt be able to fire it effectively. Innovative design continues, although it tends to be for specific applications. For instance, a knife fight is often won through luck as much as by skill. The first quick blow that connects often proves to be the one that wins. To increase your special forces' chances of winning that closely fought gamble, combine a .22 caliber pistol in the handle of the knife. Almost no noticeable addition to the weight, but for shock value and to tip the scales that extra bit, in this case, the difference between life and death, this new Russian weapon is in a class of its own.
There's no doubt the future's trends will see people turning to machine pistols. Machine pistols offer a high rate of fire, automatic fire, large magazine capacity, and they're not much more bulkier than an automatic pistol. So they will be the thing of the future, and they will gradually replace automatic pistols or semi-automatic pistols.
Nowadays they're aiming for caseless ammunition, so that they're just firing bullets and you don't have an empty cartridge case to come out. And I've read a few reports that they're aiming at railgun weapons using electromagnetism to accelerate a steel bullet, if you like, a sharp steel bullet up the barrel using superconductivity.
There is no doubt that the development of the pistol will continue. Because of its pure utility, convenience and place in history, it's a weapon that will always be with the soldier on the battlefield, wherever that may be.